हेलो फ्रेंड्स, यू ऑल आर वेलकम टू आवर योजना सीरीज एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी योजना ऑफ जून 2021. द थीम ऑफ दिस योजना इज हेल्थ एंड एनवायरनमेंट. इन दिस योजना सीरीज वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी सेवन वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टॉपिक्स. द टॉपिक वन इज कनेक्शन फॉर सर्वाइवल. हेयर देयर इज लिंक बिटवीन हेल्थ एंड एनवायरनमेंट. वी विल बी सीइंग दिस थिंग्स. देन वी विल बी सीइंग आर वी ऑन अ क्लिफ. दिस रिलेट्स टू एनवायरनमेंट एज सच. Then policy and practice, this is in the context of health. Then we will study pandemic and global strategy. This is about vaccine maitri. Vaccine maitri, this vaccine diplomacy by the government of India. Then we will see the pandemic through the Gandhian perspective, that how the relevance of Gandhian philosophy is there. Then smart agriculture, of course, how technology is, should be used and is being used to improve the various agricultural processes and production system. Then we will study e-waste management also. This is very comprehensive and very important topic for GS paper 3 and other for other GS papers. Now let us begin and study topic 1, connection for survival. The context of this topic is health is an indicator of environment. Our health is an indicator of our environment. It means that if our health is in bad shape, it means our environment is also in bad shape. So what is the status of our health will determine the status of environment also. Now let us see the study funded by ICMR. This is very important, particularly this fourth point. This is very important. This study says that 7% Indians have diabetes, 10 to 15% they are having prevalence of diabetes, that means elevated level of sugar. So they will be diabetic today or tomorrow, this is how. Then we have states which are having higher income levels, such as Gujarat and Tamil Nadu. They have higher prevalence of diabetes also. When compared to states like Bihar and Jharkhand, we have lower level of income level and lower prevalence of diabetes also. So it is one important thing that higher the income level, that means higher the economic growth, higher the prevalence of diabetes also. So one link is there. Now rural areas, they are having lower diabetes than urban areas. So this is the thing. But now see, from rural to urban, there is migration. And because of this migration, there is increasing urban poor. And these urban poor, they are having higher incidence of diabetes than the rich living in the urban area. So this is very important, because poor are now getting affected by disease of the rich and they cannot afford it. So this is one point of concern for us. Now let us see, yes, two types of diseases are there, diseases of rich and poor. Here also there is classification inequality. Diseases of poor, it means malnutrition, cholera is there. Then diseases of rich, they are largely lifestyle related diseases such as diabetes, hypertension, etc. See, the author has also pointed one very important aspect, that is the model of development. And in this article, he is in fact criticizing this, that what is the model of our development? We first pollute and then we think of cleaning it up. But this should not be the way. In fact, we should at the root level itself, we should be conscious of our environment. So this is a flawed concept, that we first pollute and then we clean up. Then he says that we chemicalize our food, we eat unhealthy such as junk food which has high salt, sugar, fat, and after eating unhealthy things, then we think about going to gym, we think about eating organic food. So this is how our thinking is flawed, our model of development is flawed. This is what being emphasized by him. Now one important question that is being raised by him is that can we avoid transition? That means the way we are becoming more and more prone to diseases such as diabetes. Can we avoid such transition? Can we become healthy? Can we avoid such lifestyle which is unhealthy and live a healthy lifestyle? So this is one question, and here he is trying to establish a link between our health and the health of the environment, and he is giving some important examples. Let us see these examples one by one. Polluted water. So the environment is in bad shape. Our water is polluted, and because of this there is waterborne disease and less than 5 mortality rate is high. Then we have air pollution, lack of clean energy. It means respiratory disease for the woman. That means the environment is in bad shape, so the health of woman is also in bad shape. Similarly, there is climate change and health linkage. Climate change is there, and that's why heat wave is there, cold wave is there, and particularly poor are becoming vulnerable. For example, construction sites. Now during summer season, they work under the sunlight, okay, and they are more prone to heat waves. But this climate change is affecting the health of rich also. How? Because rich are having AC culture, and because of this AC culture, that means air conditioned environment that they create, because of this deficiency of vitamin D is occurring. Similarly, one very important dimension the author is talking is about economy. That economy is built on use of toxins. And because of this use of toxins, the richer we get, the higher the health burden is there and higher cost of health care. Let us see example of this e-waste. Today the economy is driven by ICT, electronics, and because of these things, laptop and mobiles, all these things, e-waste is getting created, and because of this e-waste, heavy metals are getting in fact they are heavy metals are getting dissolved into water is getting affected by these things, and carcinogenic conditions, that means cancer causing conditions, are getting created. So what the author is saying, that economy is going up, economy is going up, corresponding to that toxins are also going up, and because of that the environment is getting down, that means environment is in a bad shape. The richer we are becoming, the higher the income level is going up, the higher the health burden because of this poor environmental conditions, and because of higher health burden, the cost of healthcare is also increasing. So this is how the link is. So this should be understood. Then one perspective is there, that our health is real trigger for environmental action. The author is saying that we people will be acting in favor of our planet because protecting our environment is good for us. That means our change, the behavior will get changed, because not it is in planet's interest, rather it is in our interest. That is what the Thomas Hobbes says, preservation of self, in GS paper 4 we study. So it means that once we will understand that our health is in bad shape because environment is in bad shape, then we will start improving our environment. For example, in Delhi, public health emergency situation gets created during winter season, smog conditions are there. People now have understood that their respiratory problems is because of air pollution, and that's why there is huge public cry, outcry, and that's why government is active on this, tackling the air pollution. Whether it is successful or failure, that's different aspect, but the government is trying. People have become aware that we have to deal with the environmental conditions. Similarly, one example is there, that we have to establish the link between our drying rivers and taps. Now the tap water that we receive at our home, either from river directly we are getting the water, or from groundwater we are getting water in the tap. This groundwater, if rivers get dried up, then this supply gets affected to the tap. If water river gets dried up, then the groundwater recharge will also be affected, and groundwater table will go down, and corresponding to that the tap water will get affected if it is from the groundwater. So the thing is that we have to establish a link between the drying rivers and the taps that we have in our home. So once we will establish a link between this, then we will become environment conscious. So this is how this article is. Now let us study topic 2, are we on a cliff? This topic is also very important and is from the environment perspective as such. So recently there was some incident in Chamoli, and this Chamoli is fame of Chipko movement. Author is saying that industrial revolution, it was a turning point in Earth's ecology and human relations. So human relation, human and environment interface, this human and environment interface has got changed because of industrial revolution. And after that we have industrialization, indiscriminate industrialization, proliferation of factories, indiscriminate cutting of the forests, movement of vehicles, so much vehicles moving for transportation, for tourism sector also. And all these have caused the disturbances in the ecosystem. Climate change is there because fossil fuel based economic system, developmental system that we have adopted. And that's why today our nature is under threat. For example, because of this global warming, glaciers will melt down, rivers will dry up, and then we have water scarcity. And because of this water scarcity, that means the threat to the nature, we will have threat to the world peace also. There will be third world war, and we often say that the third world war will be for water. So the nature and the world peace, both are under threat. Now in this context, the author is giving some analysis, and that analysis has three dimensions: nature, science and wisdom. Now let us see how the author want to see the things. The author is saying that today nature has got affected, and that's why there is threat to human survival, such as from global warming, climate change, and these things are creating some existential threat for the human survival. Many people, billions of people, may be losing their habitats, may be having a damaged lives. For example, coastal region people who are in coastal region. Now if sea level rise will be there because of melting glaciers and melting polar ice, sea level will rise, coastal area will get inundated, and then what will happen? There will be displacement of the coastal people. That means there will be climate refugees. So the concept of climate refugee has got cropped up. That's why there is need to change our behavior and change our thinking. Now what is the way of our thinking? We have today become greed based rather than need based. So this should be understood. Today we are need based less, greed based more. So this thinking should be removed. Then we have behavior also. What is behavior? Our behavior is becoming more and more materialistic, more and more consumerist type. What we are having in our behavior? We are moving away from the nature towards the artificial environment. Okay, so this behavior has to be changed. We need to live in harmony with the nature. That's why the concept of ecological civilization, somewhere the author has used this. Then some recent events also. The author is saying some recent events, for example, bushfire in Brazil. There is increase in the number of incidents of fire in Amazon rainforest. Then many species became extinct. Then forest fire in California. All these things the author is saying. Then science, the second dimension the author is pointing to, that the during 20th century, science and technology dominated. Many scientific developments occurred. For example, computer, ICT development, theory of relativity, electron, proton, various basic science developments and developments in the technology, field of technology has occurred during the 20th century. And that's why the economy got dominated by the technology, science and technology. And that's why there is growth in industries and services. This is how. Now, technology is value neutral. It means it is neither positive nor negative. How we use it, it will make the technology positive or it will make it negative. For example, fission reaction, we used this fission reaction to create atomic bomb and Hiroshima and Nagasaki. That means the negative impact of technology, but there is positive impact also that could have been transpired. If fission reaction, it could be used for nuclear energy generation, and then there will be less carbon footprint. That means we can effectively tackle the climate change. This is what being argued that technology is value neutral. It can be used in any fashion. Now, one more dimension is that there is greed. Of course, we have discussed, we have greed, we have become materialistic, consumerist, and then we have faulty planning also. So many, in many ecologically sensitive areas, we are creating dams, constructions. For example, in Himalayan regions, Himalayas are seismically very important, sensitive seismically. That means earthquake prone region is there, but we are building dams there. Okay, so this is some faulty planning. Then we have insensitive politics. For example, US withdrew from the Paris Pact. So this is insensitivity. Of course, there is concept of CBDR, common but differentiated responsibility, but it is not getting translated into action. So this is what the insensitive politics is there. And of course, one more dimension that the author is pointing is that the terms of market should be changed. That means the terms of market. Market is today based on the law of profit. Law of profit, for example, during COVID-19 itself, what happened? Many people, they were trying to amass wealth. They were profit oriented. But the author is saying that we have to change this idea that we need to move away from the law of profit. We need to move towards law of nature. We need to move towards ecology, environment. We need to be environment conscious. This is how. And in that context, the wisdom will play a very important role, because wisdom is the ability to make good decisions, good judgments. In fact, wisdom is not something that comes suddenly. Rather, it is experiences that the present generation has, and the experiences that has evolved during the civilizational process. That means for 5,000 years. We have a history of 5,000 years. So many good things have evolved during 5,000 years. For example, yoga and Ayurveda. Two examples which have evolved thousands of years back. This is how. Now, the author is also saying that wisdom is required to balance the development and the proper use of science. So the development and science, they should be used properly. Now, what has happened? Let us see. Tube well is there. Tube well is there. We are extracting water from the ground. Okay, groundwater is getting extracted and irrigation is getting done. So because of this irrigation, what has happened? We have improved our food production. Food sufficiency is there. Okay, now we have enough to eat. So we have used science for development. But again, we are not using proper use of science. Why? Because this tube well driven irrigation, flood irrigation, is in fact in wasting water. There is wastage of water. So what we should have done? We should have in fact gone for sprinkler, gone for drip irrigation. Okay, drip irrigation. Similarly, we have fertilizers that we are using, but fertilizers we directly add to the field. But instead of that, the concept of fertigation should be there. So in fact, what is being argued is that development should be there with the proper use of science, so that to minimize the negative externality of the developmental process. So this is how it is. The author is arguing. And then we have this path forward. What he is trying to say, the author is saying that science, wisdom. Why science should come with wisdom? Science, if it is not coming with wisdom, then the negative use of science will increase. That's why science should come with wisdom. And spirituality, that means we should move more towards nature. Okay, we should not become artificial, we should not become selfish as such. Okay. And of course, there should be ecological civilization that should be built. That means our way of living should be in harmony with the nature. And that's why there is a well-said maxim of Gandhiji, that is, there is enough for need but not for greed. We will be seeing this again in one of the articles ahead. Now let us see topic number 3, policy and practice. So this topic is in the context of health, okay, health sector. So there is Alma-Ata declaration to protect, promote health for all, a comprehensive and integrated primary health care. So these are various policies, UDHR, Universal Declaration on Human Rights, right to life, it includes health also. Then we have WHO constitution. So all these international conferences and institutions, they have their philosophy that there should be health for all, a healthy life should be there. So this is how. Now see, liberalization and privatization and its impact on health. So this is very important dimension, that after this liberalization and privatization, what happened? In fact, the states started retreating from the developmental intervention. Now there is more and more role of private sector, and the various services are now getting delivered by the private sector as such. Okay, that's why we can see in India also there is so much dominance of private sector in health sector and education sector. The outcome of this is that the states, they started retreating from the developmental intervention, and that's why the public investment, that means investment from the side of the government in the sectors like health and education, started declining. And because of this, in fact the author is against this, he is a bit critical of this aspect, that there is decline in public investment after the liberalization and privatization. So the author is saying that due to economic reforms during 1980s, what happened? In poorest 37 nations, public spending on health per head declined by half. So public investment is going down in various core sectors such as health and education also. And that's why huge shortage of doctor, medical staff, shortage of medical equipment, drugs, pathological facility. That's why people are moving towards private sector. Okay, and the private sector has its own, it may have various good things, but they have various negative aspects also. For example, we can see how for treating a dengue patient, the cost was nearly 16 lakh by one private sector. It was one issue that came in news. And of course, the policy change that we are seeing is that now there is increasing focus on free market. That means after coming of this LPG era, there is focus on free market, invisible hand. That means the demand supply dynamics, it will determine the various decision making processes, okay, and the various investments in the economy. So this free market, that means that there should be concept of laissez-faire concept, that means the government should withdraw from various sectors, and the private sector should be given a space. Okay, that's why now health today has become more centralized on individual, and it is now as a private good, not as a public good, not as a social good. So today health, it is driven by focus on individual. So an individual, if he is capable to pay for the health, he can pay for the health and have a good health. And if a poor people is not able to pay for good health, he cannot have access to good quality of health care. Okay, because now health is a private good rather than being public good. This is how. In developing countries, what happened? After this era of this LPG and market, free market, concept of free market, in developing countries, what happened? The private sector, the insurance companies, they amassed wealth, consultancy firm, pharmaceuticals, companies, private hospitals, they earned huge profit. Okay, but the quality of healthcare, it could not improve. The equity, the concept of equity, it got hampered because many poor, now they cannot have access to good quality of health care. Then efficiency for local people, that also got reduced. So this is one important aspect that for which the author is critical, that after LPG era, private sector, role of private sector increased, the government started retreating from such core sectors like health and education, and because of government retreating there, द क्वालिटी ऑफ हेल्थ केयर गॉट रिड्यूस्ड, द पुअर पीपुल कुड नॉट नाउ हैव एक्सेस टू द क्वालिटी ऑफ हेल्थ केयर एंड दैट्स वाई द इक्विटी गॉट अफेक्टेड. ओके नाउ हेयर अमिट्स गिवेन ऑल दीज थिंग्स द ऑथर इज पॉइंटिंग टू केस ऑफ थाईलैंड. ओके इनफैक्ट ही इज सेइंग दैट देयर आर मेनी अल्टरनेटिव हेल्थ सिस्टम सच एज इन क्यूबा एंड थाईलैंड. इन थाईलैंड व्हाट हैपेंस, देयर इज यूनिवर्सल हेल्थ कवरेज फॉर ऑल पीपल, यूनिवर्सल हेल्थ कवरेज. देयर इज इक्विटेबल हेल्थ सर्विस डिलीवरी विथ रेगुलेशन लाइक 3 years ऑफ कंपल्सरी रूरल सर्विस. सो इन दैट कंट्री आफ्टर गेटिंग क्वालिफाइड फॉर हेल्थ, गेटिंग द डिग्री फॉर हेल्थ, people have to serve compulsorily for 3 years in the rural area. So it will solve the problem of equity, it will solve the problem of efficiency, access, okay, quality. So this is how people have to necessarily serve 3 years in the rural areas. Then again in the Thailand we can see one is the universal health care, this should be kept in mind. Then again they have started moving away from urban hospital to primary health care. Now there is more focus on primary health care. Why? Because primary health care, in fact what happens, primary health care, then in fact India also there is primary health care, then community health center, then we have secondary, tertiary, secondary care, then tertiary care is there. So at PSC level there can not only be curative, there can not only be curative care but also preventive care. So what it means that when there will be preventive care, it means that there will be less need to go to the second tier and third tier. Okay, so that's why a special focus on primary health care should be there, and this is what being adopted in Thailand. So this is one alternative system that the author has pointed to. Now let us see the case of India. So in case of India, the expenditure, public expenditure on health per capita is lower than even Sri Lanka. Okay, then WHO norm, we can see this data also. Then we have this, as per WHO 2015, undernutrition, malnutrition is a major cause of death in 45% of deaths among children. Okay, less than 5 mortality rate, 45% is because of malnutrition and undernutrition. This is the status of health in India during this period. Then we can see that the global hunger index, in that also India has a score of 97/107, and in that index report we can see that under 5 wasted, 17% children are wasted under 5, under 5 34% children they are stunted. Okay, then 14% population of India is undernourished. So this is the status of India, India's health. Okay, the health of India's population today. Now in this context there is National Health Policy 2017. What this policy is saying, it is saying that 2.5% of GDP should be spent on health. Today it is nearly 1.03%, something like this, and out of this expenditure 2.5% of GDP, 70% should be primary health care, such as in Thailand as we discussed above. And as we discussed in case of Thailand, universal health coverage by 2030 is also aim of this national health policy. Then the author is coming to shift in public health delivery, and he is saying that, he is suggesting some aspects that there should be some shift in the policy. For example, in primary care, he is saying that from selective care we should move to the comprehensive care. If I give one example, then you will understand. For example, in sub center, okay, in some center or in primary health care, the delivery is normal delivery. Normal delivery for institutional delivery, normal delivery is there. But if C-section is required, then the patient has to be referred to the higher institution, CSC. Okay, the author is saying that from selective care, we need to have comprehensive care at the primary level itself. So at primary level itself, we should have all sort of care, health care that should be provided. Also it should be preventive, and also it should be curative. So primary level health care should be comprehensive. This should be the shift in our policy, the author is saying. Okay, then we have secondary and tertiary care. Here the author is saying that try to understand this very carefully. The author is saying that at secondary and tertiary care, there should be we should move away from input oriented to output based strategic purchasing. Okay, it means that rather than building a big rather than having big buildings, so many staffs, so much input oriented inputs, that should not be given. Rather than that, we should go for strategic purchasing. So here the author is somehow favoring private sector. Okay, that means we should purchase from the private sector various healthcare that should be based on output. Okay, so here the author is saying that two things keep in mind. At primary care, he is saying that from selective care, comprehensive care should be given, preventive care, curative care, and one example that we have given. But at secondary and tertiary care, he is saying that rather than giving so much input in terms of main material money, we should go for strategic purchasing from the private sector. Okay, so this is how. Then he is saying that in public hospitals, user fees, cost recovery, these things, there should be free drugs, diagnostics, all these things. Then in terms of infrastructure and HRD, he is saying that normative to targeted approach. We should move from normative approach, that normative means based on norms, based on standards. Rather than this, we should move towards targeted approach. For example, what it means. Today we have this PSC, CSC, etc. based on population. Based on population, so it is the standard on which these are set up. So norm based on which this is set up. But it may amount to various underserved areas, okay, various overserved areas. So this can happen. That's why he is saying that we should target, we have a targeted approach. Okay, what is the need there and what we have to achieve there. So based on this, we should have infrastructure and human resource there. Then he is saying that in case of urban health, there should be intervention on a larger scale. Okay, so not a token intervention that we have a hospital, Sadar Hospital, and that hospital does not have drugs and diagnostics. So rather than having token intervention, that yes, we are having some intervention, having hospitals, staffs, there should be large scale, and in reality there should be intervention. Okay, then he is saying that Ayush services should be integrated, it should not left as standalone, it should be mainstreamed. Okay, because Ayush has preventive, it can help in preventive healthcare, and preventive healthcare it will decrease the burden of healthcare. Many health, for example, in case of non-communicable diseases, yoga, it can help a lot. Okay, so Ayush should be mainstream. This is how the author is trying to say. Then another dimension that we should study, is the gender disparity. It is very important dimension that there is gender disparity in healthcare also. And two things we should keep in mind. One is one data that is from AIIMS, only 70% patients those visited were women. Only 37%. Okay. And in developed countries also there is this discrimination, because many in fact women are also suffering from heart diseases in the same fashion as men, but women are less treated, less recognized. So in developed countries also there is this discrimination. Now see, what is specific about women? Women, they have different physiology. Okay, they have a smaller organs, they have higher fat content, they have hormonal driven body system. That's why this should be kept in mind. But what happens, researchers, they keep in their mind males, and males are taken as reference for various development and various research, okay, on drugs or whatever. So male is the reference. So this is what the gender disparity, it should be removed. Then we have another dimension, that is mental health. So adequate consciousness is not there. Many people are mentally ill today, but they are not and their families are also not aware that they are having mental illness. Facilities are also inadequate. National health survey, we can see there's some data that mental illness in 13.7%, such a big amount. Mental illness is prevailing among 13.7% population, 28% society is also mental illness. Then we have, of course, no mental facility within 25 kilometer radius to nearly 50%. So 50% population, they have to travel more than 25 kilometer to avail mental health care. So this is a very challenging thing. So this should be kept in mind. Now let us come to topic number 4. This topic number 4 is pandemic and global strategy, and the context of this topic is the India's vaccine diplomacy. Okay, now see, during this pandemic, what happened? The whole world got affected in terms of social impact, economic impact, political, cultural impact, all these things are there. One thing is there, that because the countries are interconnected, because of this globalized world, the disease proliferated, and that's why there is some anti-feeling towards globalization. The author is saying that today, when the concept of global village, the concept of globalization is getting affected because of this pandemic, then we have to justify that no, this globalization and global village is very important. We have to defend it. Okay. Now, he is saying that vaccine development, various vaccine development on the nationalist lines, we can see nationalist lines that many countries were, and in fact, even today, they are trying to develop their vaccines, and they are trying to focus firstly on their own population. So, nationalist lines. So, here, nationalist lines is dominating. But on the other hand, we can see that national, international efforts are also there, collaboration is there between manufacturing companies and laboratories. So for example, in India, the Indian pharmaceutical companies, they are to produce vaccines, okay, in collaboration with other countries. So in news we can often see these things. So there are both sides. On one side there is nationalist lines, on the other side there is internationalist thinking also in this context. Now see, India has in fact gone for vaccine maitri, that is the vaccine diplomacy, and this is based on Bahujan Hitaye and Bahujan Sukhaye. That means many people should be benefited, many people should be happy. This is how. And India has, of course, earned recognition because of that. India has scientific skill, professionalism, all these things are there with India, and that's why India has the capability to build, to manufacture vaccines and to distribute it to the poor countries, for example Bhutan, Maldives, Afghanistan, Caribbean islands, Pacific islands. So almost in every nook and corner of the world, India has sent its vaccine, which are also cheapest, which are, and India is largest producer of vaccine. Of course, here one thing is very important, that developed countries, they have in fact shown more tendency towards reserving their doses beyond their need. So they need 100, but now they are producing 200 and also keeping those 200 doses with themselves. So they are not trying to distribute it to the poor countries, and poor countries, if they are largely unprotected, because they cannot afford to pay. So the developed countries are not so much benevolent in this case. So here the significance of India's vaccine maitri has gained some importance. Now see, conceptual understanding of power. So when this Bertrand Russell, he has seen, in fact we are going to study soft power, okay, and that's why this these things. Bertrand Russell says that power is production of intended effects. So when intended effects are getting produced, then it is power. So if today US says to China that you remove your army from South China Sea, then, and China removes, then it means that US is having the intended effects. So this is one conservative idea that I have tried to explain. Intended effects are there, then this is power. Similarly, Robert Dahl has said that power is a kind of influence when compliance is attained by creating prospect of severe sanctions for non-compliance. In simple terms, इफ समवन इज नॉट डूइंग समथिंग ही गेट्स पनिश्ड फॉर नॉट डूइंग दिस थिंग्स ओके एंड बिकॉज ऑफ दिस फियर ऑफ गेटिंग पनिश्ड इफ दैट पर्सन इज डूइंग थिंग देन इट इज पावर ओके दैट दिस इज हाउ रॉबर्ट दहल इज देन देर इज थर्ड देन देर इज अनदर फेस ऑफ दिस पावर दैट इज सॉफ्ट पावर एंड दिस सॉफ्ट पावर इज नॉट बिकॉज ऑफ टेंजेबल थ्रेट ओके एंड इंडियाज वैक्सीन डिप्लोमेसी इज इन फैक्ट दिस सॉफ्ट पावर एंड दिस सॉफ्ट पावर हैज थ्री इंपॉर्टेंट फ्यूजन इंडियाज कल्चर इंडियाज पॉलिटिक्स एंड इंडियाज फॉरन पॉलिटिक्स इंडियाज कल्चर इन इंडिया वी हैव बहुजन हिताय एंड बहुजन सुखाय मैनी पीपल शुड बी बेनिफिटेड मैनी पीपल शुड बी हैप्पी एंड देन वसुधैव कुटुंबकम द होल वर्ल्ड इज अ फैमिली सो दिस इज द कल्चर ऑफ इंडिया एंड दैट्स वाई इंडिया हैज वैक्सीन मैत्री दैट इट इज सेंडिंग वैक्सीन टू होल वर्ल्ड बिकॉज होल वर्ल्ड इज अ फैमिली एंड होल वर्ल्ड शुड बी बेनिफिटेड एंड होल वर्ल्ड शुड बी हैप्पी ओके देन द पॉलिटिकल आइडियोलॉजी बिकॉज इंडिया इज अ डेमोक्रेटिक कंट्री दैट्स वाई द इम्पॉर्टेंस ऑफ पीपल इज वेरी मच ओके ह्यूमनिज्म इज ऑल्सो गिवेन इम्पॉर्टेंस देन वी हैव फॉरन पॉलिटिक्स सो इंडिया इज अ रिस्पॉन्सिबल ग्लोबल प्लेयर ऑफकोर्स बिकॉज इंडिया इज टेकिंग केयर ऑफ द होल वर्ल्ड थ्रू दिस वैक्सीन मैत्री एज पर इट्स कैपेसिटी सो इंडिया डिजर्व्स यूनाइटेड नेशन सिक्योरिटी काउंसिल परमानेंट मेंबरशिप सो दिस इज वन डायमेंशन वाई इंडिया शुड बी गिवेन परमानेंट मेंबरशिप नाउ आफ्टर डिस्कसिंग ऑल दीज थिंग्स सम एस्पेक्ट्स आर देयर दिस ऑल दीज थ्री आर इनफैक्ट क्वेश्चन इन देमसेल्व्स ओके सो यू शुड ट्राई टू गिव अ थॉट टू दीज थ्री डायमेंशंस एंड डेवलप सम परस्पेक्टिव वन इज दैट हार्ड पावर इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एंड बिकॉज ऑफ दिस सॉफ्ट पावर कैन नॉट बी थॉरली रिलाइड अपॉन सो वी कैन नॉट रिलाई अपॉन सॉफ्ट पावर ओनली इट कैन नॉट बी एब्सोल्यूट सो वी हैव टू फोकस ऑन हार्ड पावर ऑल्सो दिस इज वन डायमेंशन देन सी इंडिया इज सीन बाई इट्स नेबर्स फ्रॉम ड्यूअल परस्पेक्टिव सो इंडिया इज गिविंग वैक्सीन इट इज हेल्पिंग द कंट्रीज इन इट्स नेबरहुड फॉर एग्जाम्पल भूटान नेपाल बट दे सी डैट इंडिया हैज अ बिग ब्रदरली एटीट्यूड इंडिया इज हैविंग हेजमनी ओके सो दिस इज हाउ दे परसीव इंडिया एज सो दिस इज वन इम्पॉर्टेंट डायमेंशन ऑफ दिस इज वन इम्पॉर्टेंट डायमेंशन ऑफ इंडियाज रिलेशनशिप फॉरन रिलेशनशिप विद द नेबरहुड एंड दिस हैज सिग्निफिकेंस गिवेन चाइनीज फुटप्रिंट इंक्रीजिंग इन साउथ एशिया ओके सो दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट देन द थर्ड डायमेंशन इज ट्रेडिशनल डिप्लोमेसी इज गेटिंग डायल्यूटेड वाई बिकॉज नाउ देर इज ग्लोबलाइजेशन एंड बिकॉज ऑफ दिस ग्लोबलाइजेशन वेरियस नॉन स्टेट एक्टर्स दे आर कमिंग ऑन फ्रंट लाइक एनजीओज सिविल सोसाइटीज एमएनसीज लाइक फेसबुक गूगल दे आर हैविंग सो मच इन्फ्लुएंस ट्विटर दे आर हैविंग सो मच इन्फ्लुएंस इन द इंटरनेशनल पॉलिटिक्स ओके सो द ट्रेडिशनल डिप्लोमेसी दैट वॉज वंस ड्रिवन बाई द स्टेट्स ओके द रिलेशनशिप बिटवीन स्टेट्स बियॉन्ड दैट नॉन स्टेट एक्टर्स आर ऑल्सो इमर्जिंग सो द कॉम्प्लेक्सिटी ऑफ द डिप्लोमेसी हैज इंक्रीज सो दिस इज ऑल्सो वन वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट डायमेंशन ऑन विच वी मस्ट हैव सम कंटेंट्स एंड सम पर्सपेक्टिव ओके नाउ लेट अस स्टडी दिस टॉपिक फाइव द पैंडेमिक थ्रू गांधीयन परस्पेक्टिव एंड इन फैक्ट वी आर गोइंग टू सी हाउ देर इज रेलिवेंस ऑफ गांधीयन फिलोसफी ओके सो फर्स्ट लेट अस सी द फंडामेंटल्स ऑफ गांधीयन फिलोसफी सो द फर्स्ट थिंग इज दैट इकोनॉमी शुड बी बेस्ड ऑन नॉन वायलेंस एंड ट्रूथ दीज आर टू कार्डिनल प्रिंसिपल्स ऑफ गांधीयन फिलोसफी देन नॉन कोवेटसनेस दैट मीन्स ग्रीडीनेस शुड नॉट बी देयर ग्रीड शुड नॉट बी देयर देन नॉन एक्विजिटिवनेस दैट मीन्स अपरिग्रह द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ अपरिग्रह ओके दैट मीन्स देर शुड नॉट बी द फीलिंग दैट वी शुड अक्वायर वेल्थ सो दिस इज द कॉन्सेप्ट ऑफ अपरिग्रह ओके देन द सेकेंड कॉन्सेप्ट इज प्रिंसिपल ऑफ ट्रस्टीशिप इट इन फैक्ट गांधी जी इज ऑफ द ओपिनियन दैट द इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट आर मियर ट्रस्टी ओके इंडस्ट्री दे हैव टू मेक प्रॉफिट ओके फॉर सर्वाइवल बट प्रॉफिट बिलोंग्स टू द सोसाइटी बिकॉज द सोसाइटी इज प्रोवाइडिंग एवरी पॉसिबल रिसोर्सेज टू द इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट एंड दैट्स वाई द प्रॉफिट शुड ऑल्सो बिलोंग टू द सोसाइटी इट मीन्स दैट द इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट आर मियर ट्रस्टीज And from here, the concept of corporate social responsibility has also emerged. Then the concept of dignity of labor. So many a times Gandhiji has said that we should do some a few hours of manual work also. So he emphasized on manual work and the dignity of labor. Then he said the concept of Gram Swaraj. Gram Swaraj, that means the village should be self-sufficient, village economy, there should be a strong village economy, Gram Swaraj should be there. Then containment of wants, okay, so the wants should be need-based, okay, and not greed-based. So greed-based should not be there, there should be need-based. Then we can see there is positive economics and this is Gandhian system. So Gandhian system is saying that there should be containment of wants, so it should be need-based, okay. But economics, positive economics, it is of the opinion that wants are insatiable. So it cannot be satisfied. Wants are, in fact, wants are open-ended. So this is how positive economics. Then positive economics is saying that resources are limited. But Gandhi is saying that, see, resources are enough, but for need. If people think about our need, then we have enough resources, but we don't have resources for our greed. So this is how these two system. Then economy is based on greed. Of course, today we can see that how economy is based on greed. Some examples are there. Greed breeds violence. Whenever there will be greed, there will be violence created, okay, because there will be exploitation of others. Now some examples are there. Squeezing wages, exploitation of worker. Why? Because workers will be given less wages, then there will be more profit. So it means there is violence, some sort of violence on the worker. Okay, this is how this concept is. Then we can see that there is unequal land holding. There are many landless workers. They are in fact the real tillers. They are real farmers, but they don't own land. Okay. So there is unequal land holding. This is also one manifestation of greed in the economic system that we are having today. Okay. Then Gandhiji is also saying that we are creating conditions. If we are creating some circumstances which is forcing people to migrate. Okay. And we can see that people are migrating from rural to urban area. Why? Because they are living in poverty conditions, and if they are getting forced to migrate, then it means they are facing some sort of violence at the societal level. So this is what Gandhiji is against. And Gandhiji is saying that we should have a strong village committee, a self-sufficient village committee. That means people should not be forced to migrate. Okay. If they are migrating, then that will be their choice. There will not be use of force. Okay. Now see dimensions of dignity of labor. The first dimension is that if we emphasize the dignity of labor, it means that no labor is menial. So every people doing what type of labor, that person has dignity. His labor is of no low class. Okay, this thing should be kept in mind, that the dignity of labor means no labor is menial, whether one is sweeper or one is doing some other type of labor. So dignity of labor should be there. So the concept of equality is there, the concept of humanity is there. So this is one important dimension, and that's why Gandhiji also suggested that some manual work we should be doing a few hours, so that our physical and mental health should be in good shape. Then comes another dimension of dignity of labor, that when we will recognize labor as such, the dignity of labor, it means that we will recognize the man who is behind the machine. So rather than giving importance to machine, we will be giving importance to man. That means man will be treated with decency. They will be given healthy working conditions. They will be given reasonable wages. So this is how this dimension of dignity of labor as per the Gandhian philosophy. Now let us see how during the current pandemic, we can see some reflections of Gandhian philosophy. So changing consumption pattern. So what is the Gandhian philosophy about consumption? That there should be containment of wants. Containment of wants. Our consumption should be need based, not greed based. So this is the Gandhian philosophy. During lockdown, what happened? People started differentiating between whether it is essential consumption or non-essential. So we were focusing on essential consumption. That means containment of want was there. Okay, then again we were moving towards natural and herbal remedies, healthy lifestyle, so that our immunity could boost up. So this is how we were moving towards nature. This is also in line with the Gandhian philosophy. Then changing pattern of production. So production is also getting influenced. How? Because UNCTAD report, one report is that the global value chain is now moving towards local. Okay, so there is now more focus on local skill and materials, and this is in line with Gram Swaraj. So Gandhiji is of the opinion that the economy should be local based. The economy should be such that the gram should be self-sufficient. That means local level resources, local level skill, all these things were given emphasized by Gandhiji. Then comes the concept of Atmanirbhar Bharat. Atmanirbhar Bharat that Honorable Prime Minister propounded last year. So that is also in line with self-sufficiency, Gram Swaraj. So Gandhian philosophy is there. Then empathy towards deprived. This is also very much in line with the Gandhian philosophy. During lockdown, migrant crisis was there. Many people rose to the occasion and they started providing food, shelter, all these things. So humanity was being shown, and this is what Gandhiji wants, that there should be humanism. Now, why this crisis was there? Because of rural-urban imbalance causing migration. This is what we discussed above, that at a societal level, people are facing exploitation, violence, because they are getting forced to migrate from rural to urban areas. This is how. Then what is needed? That agriculture should be improved, and of course the dependence on agriculture should also be reduced. So non-farm sector employment should be generated, for example in agro-based food processing industries. This is how the authorities are going. Then of course women, they are also a vulnerable section, and during this lockdown they faced domestic violence. Many data is there suggesting that they faced domestic violence and substance abuse by males, and this substance abuse is against Gandhi, against Gandhian philosophy, temperance. This is how. Then the treatment to reverse migrants. Here what the author is saying, that migrants who have come back to their home, okay, and now they have some home based business. So these migrants can be brought together. These migrants can be brought together and a cluster can be formed. A cluster, a cooperative can be formed. Okay, and in this, through this cooperative, through this cluster, they can pull together their resources, skills, etc., and they can improve better, they can perform better, they can enjoy economies of scale based on this. So meaning that cooperative should be developed, and this cooperative is in fact in line with the Gandhian philosophy, because Gandhiji is in favor of decentralized process of growth. So rather than centralization of industrial sector and all economic sector, the migrants who have come back to their rural areas, their villages, to their home, they should be brought together to form the cooperatives, and this will facilitate decentralization of the process of growth. Decentralization of process of growth, again, this is what Gram Swaraj is. Okay, village based economy, it is decentralization of process of growth. This is how Gandhian philosophy here. Then urban development, what happened? See, COVID-19, because of this, cleanliness and hygiene, this become very important buzzword. And see, in slum areas, such as in Mumbai and Maharashtra, we can see, and the living condition is very poor, and that's why this was one of the major cause of spread of COVID-19. And that's why ignoring hygiene there, it means it is in fact risking survival of everybody throughout the country. So from there itself, the COVID-19 could have spread to every part of the country. So this is how that slum should have living conditions, should have hygienic conditions, should have cleanliness. And Gandhiji said that cleanliness is next to godliness. So here again Gandhian philosophy. And again decent living standard if it is ensured to these people who are living in slum areas. It is also implicit in dignity of labor. That means when we will give recognition to labor and we will recognize this dignity of labor, it means we will ensure a decent living standard to those people who are doing labor, of any type of labor. No labor is menial. This is how Gandhiji is saying. And then one important this line, an infection everywhere is a threat to health everywhere. Then decent wages and COVID allowance. Of course, we can see that outflow facing states, they faced the labor shortage, and that's why now they are trying to attract laborers by giving them more wages, more remuneration. This is how it is. That means they are recognizing dignity of labor. So this is how the various Gandhian philosophies and the pandemic that we have seen. Now let us come to topic number 6. This is a smart agriculture. This is a dimension of agriculture where we have to integrate technology with the agricultural production system, agricultural processes and production system. And the technology that we have to integrate is the emerging one, IoT, artificial intelligence, machine learning, big data, all these new developments that we are seeing during Industrial Revolution 4.0, this can be used and should be integrated with the agricultural processes. This is what is being emphasized in this article. Okay, and these are data you can study on your own, how nearly 55% of India's population is dependent on agriculture and allied sector for livelihood. Then we have 17.8% of gross value added, only this much amount. 55% workforce dependent on agriculture and allied sector, and only 17.8% of these people, sector adding to the gross value added. Okay. Then see the yield is 50% lower than US. Average farm size is less than 1 hectare. Small and marginal farmers, nearly 86% of farmers are small and marginal farmers. These are the data you should keep in mind. Now see, there are hindrances in agricultural potential, in achieving the agricultural production, potential rather. So one is that there is expensive technologies. We are not very much able to invest in expensive technologies. For example, farmers are poor, particularly in Eastern India, farmers are poor, so they cannot invest in expensive technology. Okay. And in expensive inputs. Then we can see that there are large number of intermediaries across value chains. So farmers, crop from farmer, okay, and crop to consumer. Between these two extremities, there are so much layers. This is layer of intermediaries. So farmers are not getting what consumers are paying. This is one problem. Again, the next problem is access to credit is not there. Access of credit is not there. It is a topic in itself. But we will confine ourselves that access to credit is also not there to the real agriculturists. Okay. Limited sales channels, lack of digital infrastructure. This is another dimension. For example, lack of digital infrastructure, eNAM. Okay. eNAM is not very much successful because of this lack of digital infrastructure. And even if there is digital infrastructure, farmers are not tech savvy. They are not very much comfortable with the digital world. Digital literacy is poor. Anyways, now the focus is in fact on use of adoption of agri-tech, agricultural technology. So what is agri-tech, agricultural technology? So all those technology and tools that are trying to improve the yield, efficiency, profitability. And how these things are to be achieved? Yield efficiency by leveraging these new technologies. Okay, these new technologies that will be employed in the agricultural processes. And this is how the agricultural processes will become efficient. The yield will improve. Now see, for example, this drone. Let us see this example of drone. So drone can be used to monitor the health of crops can be monitored. Then drones can be used to spray pesticides, okay, from the aerial spray can be done by drones. So this is one example. Okay. Similarly, sensors. Sensors can be used in the agricultural fields to understand the various conditions prevailing in the farm. For example, there is one Fasal, one startup that is Fasal. This startup is in fact using sensor. They are using sensor and they are trying to capture the real time data, okay, using these sensors. Data about what? Data about the various farm conditions that is prevailing, such as temperature condition, such as humidity condition, such as health of crops, such as growth of crops. So various data is getting collected by the sensors. This Fasal, one startup, is doing this, and based on this they are sending some recommendations on mobile, through SMS, through phone calls. They are sending the recommendations to the farmers, and that in that process, in that way, the farmers are getting benefit of technology. They are getting some good recommendations, actionable recommendations based on the need, okay, for the crops and the for the farm. So this is how one very good example. Now let us come back to our agenda. Yes, now where we were discussing, yes, these things, IoT, big data, all these things, they are now being integrated into the agricultural processes, and this is what AgriTech is doing. So using these things like sensor, drones, what we are doing, we are getting collecting data about weather, soil, climatic conditions, and based on these, various decision making can be done. Various predictive technologies are getting used, okay. So AI, machine learning, they can predict the erratic weather. So erratic weather, one of the unknown in the agriculture, is this erratic weather, and this erratic weather can be predicted using AI, machine learning. So this is how the integration of technology with the agricultural processes. Similarly, there can be use of this technology in dairy sector also to monitor the health, nutrition of cattle. Drones can be used to track the herd. So this is how the things are. In AgriTech, there are various actors like think tank, various stakeholders, think tank, research laboratories, then government is there also, because regulation is there, various policies to be made by the government which can favor this growth of AgriTech, then incubators, startups, all these things are there. See, AgriTech startups, they have in fact many innovations. One example, Fasal, we have given. Similarly, we can see that there are many innovations to bridge various gaps. For example, Dehat, this is one Dehat is there, and this Dehat, what is it is doing? This through on this app, farmers can buy the inputs. On this app, farmers can sell their outputs. So this is how between the farmer and the market, okay, the intermediaries are getting reduced. The intermediaries are getting removed. So this is how the startups are very much helpful. Now, what the challenges are there? The challenges are that the solutions are largely blanket solutions. So that is umbrella type. It is not focusing on one particular region, the needs of one particular region, because each region has its own geography, has its own socio-cultural aspects, demographic requirements. So this micro level aspect is not getting solved. This is one thing. Then we have agricultural sector is itself highly fragmented and unorganized. We can see one example. In villages, this is one piece of land. It is owned by someone else and it is cultivated by someone else. So this is fragmented structure, unorganized, something like this. Then this cultivator, once he has got his crops yield harvested, then he goes to sell, but between these there are so many intermediaries, and also they have to give the some amount of this to the owner also. So this is how agriculture system is not well organized in India. Okay, of course, the next point is that smallholders, they are not very much वेरी मच ईगर टू एक्सेप्ट द टेक्नोलॉजीज, बिकॉज टेक्नोलॉजीज मे नॉट बी कॉस्ट इफेक्टिव, दे मे नॉट बी वायबल, एंड ऑल्सो दे मे नॉट बी टेक सेवी. पेनिट्रेशन ऑफ टेक्नोलॉजी इज ऑल्सो लो. फॉर एग्जाम्पल इन रूरल एरियाज, इवन टूडे द इंटरनेट स्पीड मे नॉट बी एज मच एज वी सी इन दिल्ली और मुंबई. दिस इज हाउ इट इज. सो दिस थिंग्स शुड बी केप्ट इन माइंड. नाउ लेट अस सी द टॉपिक नंबर 7. इन दिस टॉपिक वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी अबाउट ई वेस्ट मैनेजमेंट. दिस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट एंड वेरी कॉम्प्रिहेंसिव टॉपिक, एंड जीएस पेपर 3 मेनी क्वेश्चंस कैन बी देयर इन अदर पेपर्स ऑल्सो. सी द कॉन्टेक्स्ट ऑफ दिस टॉपिक इज दैट देयर शुड बी सेकेंड लाइफ फॉर डिजिटल डेबरी. दैट मीन्स देयर शुड बी रिसाइकल एंड रीयूज. दिस इज हाउ. इनफैक्ट टू इम्प्रूव रिसाइकलिंग कैपेसिटी इन इंडिया, इंडिया इज लार्जली इन द अप्रोच इन इंडिया इज सब्सिडी बेस्ड, बट द ऑथर इज आर्गुइंग दैट इट शुड बी मार्केट बेस्ड मैकेनिज्म. सो ऑन दिस बेसिस वी विल बी एनालाइजिंग दिस टॉपिक. बट बिफोर दैट दिस फैक्ट्स आर देयर, दिस फैक्ट शुड बी केप्ट इन माइंड. ई वेस्ट वैल्यू चेन. सो वी कैन सी दैट ई वेस्ट वे इट वेन ई वेस्ट इज जनरेटेड, वेन द फर्स्ट यूजर ऑफ प्रोडक्ट इट सेज दैट नाउ वी हैव यूज द प्रोडक्ट एंड इट इज ऑफ नो लॉन्गर यूज. इट इज इट कैन नॉट बी यूज एनी लॉन्गर. सो वेन इट इज डिस्कार्डेड देन इट इज ई वेस्ट. सो द फर्स्ट यूजर इज डिस्कार्डिंग द इलेक्ट्रॉनिक आइटम, देन इट इज द ई वेस्ट. देयर आर वेरियस स्टेक होल्डर्स इन ई वेस्ट. सो इम्पोर्टर, प्रोड्यूसर, मैन्युफैक्चरर, रिटेलर्स इज देयर, देन कंज्यूमर्स, वेन दो जो कंज्यूम, ट्रेडर्स, स्क्रैप डीलर्स, डिसेम्बलर्स, dismantler, recycler. So there are various stakeholders. Four stage process there: generation of e-waste, then there is collection of e-waste, segregation, treatment and disposal. So this is how we should keep in mind. Now see India's regulatory ecosystem. This is very important dimension. There is increased production, penetration of imported electronic items, and that's why there is e-waste generation. So e-waste generation is so much there. Because production is there, demand is so much there of this electronics, and that's why e-waste generation is very much. And if corresponding to this, the need of this e-waste management, one regulation was there in 2008 by government, and responsible e-waste management, this was coined that there should be responsible e-waste management. But then again in 2011 there was some changes in the rules and some important points were added. One is that the concept of EPR, extended producers responsibility, extended producers responsibility, this concept of EPR, it got incorporated in 2011 rules. What is this EPR? This EPR says that the producers, they have to collect the electronic items and they have to recycle it. That means now the burden of e-waste management has shifted on the manufacturers, those who are producers. They have the responsibility to collect back these e-waste e-items, discarded e-items, and to recycle those items. Now what it meant when the burden is on the producer? It means that they have now incentive that they will be using eco-friendly product designs. That means to minimize the disposal cost, because when eco-friendly products will be there, then the disposal cost will be less. So this is one thing. Then they will also use less and less toxic and easily recyclable materials. So this is one very important aspect, that when EPR is there, it means that the burden is there on the manufacturers, and when the burden is on the manufacturers, it means that they will go more and more eco-friendly. This is how it is. But one issue was there. EPR was not quantified. It was not quantified. No target was there. It means there was something missing. And in 2016, this 2011 rules was amended, and then two things were included. One is the collection target was included. Some collection was there. Collection target was there. And the second is DRS system, deposit refund system. Deposit refund system was also incorporated in 2016. rules. So what is this deposit refund system? It means that when a person is buying some product, okay, then the deposit, some charge is there that is taken from the consumers, and when the consumer is going to the producer after using that item, when goes back to the producer and returns the product, then that amount, deposited amount, is refunded. So this is the DRS system. Now see, again in 2018 some amendments were there and the collection targets were a bit tweaked with some minor changes were there in the collection targets, and also one important aspect was added during 2018 amendments. That was the concept of PRO, Producer Responsibility Organization. What is this PRO? Is these PROs are in fact trying to help the producers. They are trying to help the producers to comply with the e-waste rules. So to comply with the e-waste rules, to help the producers, the concept of these PROs came. What these PROs do? These PROs, on behalf of producers, these PROs, they negotiate the collection, regional collection, which is most cost effective. So those people who are collecting, so PROs establish a link with them, those who are collecting, and that should be done in a cost effective manner. So PROs are helping producers in collect back. Similarly, PROs, they will help these producers in negotiating the recycling contracts. That means the terms and conditions of recycling. This is how. And these PROs will help in generating the awareness also. So this is how the concept of PROs, Producer Responsibility Organizations, this concept has been incorporated in 2018 amendments also. So this is also very important. Now see, what is the status of e-waste generation and this recycling in India? 95% e-waste is in fact today managed by informal sector, and there is inferior working conditions because there is no safety gear. The people, they are not having skills, they are not having awareness, they are very poor, vulnerable people. They don't know what are the bad impacts, adverse impacts of these handling these e-wastes. Okay, then the second thing is that their techniques they use are very crude. They are not using some scientific basis of and scientific instruments for dismantling the e-waste. Therefore the policy is now, government is trying to make policies which will formalize this sector. That means formalize e-waste recycling sector. Okay, but there are some issues. One issue is the price competencies. The issue with the informal cycler is that they have less operating cost because they don't have to comply with the various administrative requirements, they don't have overheads, various costs that are there added because of being formal sector, that are not there with the informal sector, and that's why they have cost effectiveness. Therefore they can offer better price to the aggregators. Aggregator means those who are collecting the e-waste. So they can get greater price from the informal recyclers. So this is one challenge of price competency. Then government is trying to plug this financial gap, but through subsidies, monetary support. Okay, but the author is against this. He is saying that there should be market-based mechanism rather than subsidy-based. The second thing is that informal network, they have well established, and it rests on social capital. But PROs, they are largely professional, okay, they don't have personal relation in the local area. But the informal sectors, they have personal relations in the local area, personal networks in the local area. So they can easily get the e-waste collected. But the PROs, they don't have, they have not yet been able to establish that network, that social capital. So this is another challenge. And besides these two, there are other challenges also, such as the fund that is flowing from the producers to meet the EPR targets, that is also unsteady and also less than required. Then transparency is not there, enforcement is lacking. So all these things are there. So these are other challenges. why we are not able to formalize this sector. This is how. Now recommendations, what the author is saying. First, he is saying that Malthusian and Cornucopian, see these two opposite ideas he is trying to compare. Malthusian says that resources are limited. Malthusian idea that resources are limited. But Cornucopian says that resources are plenty. The only thing is that how we are able to adapt and adopt, that will compensate for the shortage of resources. For example, let us see, petrol. Petrol is getting reduced in amount, but we can increase the efficiency of the engines. Efficiency of the engines. So earlier, what 1 liter petrol could do, because of increased efficiency of the machines, half liter petrol could do these things. So this is what adaptation and adoption of the design the author is saying. But the thing is that in this point of view, resources are plenty. But Malthusian says that resources are limited. Then Malthusian is focusing on sustainable development. That means there should be recycling. There should be recycling, because recycling is cost effective. Cost effective. It reduces the need to mine new metals. Okay. So it is more environment friendly, and the sustainable development is there. But Cornucopian, what it says? Cornucopian idea, it says that there should be planned obsolescence. Planned obsolescence means that today we have one mobile which has a speed of X, but after 6 months we have another mobile with new features and that has increased speed, Y speed. Then we have a technology X, but after 6 months we have technology Y. That means this technology X 6 months before has become obsolete. So there is short span of E items. So one mobile which can run for 4 years becomes obsolete in 6 months. So this is what sustainable development, it is against sustainable development. Okay. So short span of E items due to rapid pace of technology, improved specific, better performance. So these things, in fact, they lead to planned obsolescence. This is how. Then, so how we should go for Malthusian. This is what the recommendation is. Greater extractions and recycling capabilities. Then the second recommendation is that we should have a better recycling capability. Means that there should be more focus on recycling. Collect back program should be there. Introduce DRS we discussed above should be there. Then discount for exchange of products. So if consumer are going to exchange their products, so discount should be given, so that there should be easily collect back. Okay. DRS has one good thing, is that it can create inventories of total waste generated, because every time one E item is sold, corresponding to that DRS is deposited, some fund is deposited. So based on this, we can create one inventory that how much electronic item is there in the market. Okay. And when the person comes back and returns that E item, then he is refunded. Then how much amount is refunded? So based on this, how much fund is collected and how much fund is refunded, based on this one inventory is created, where we can have idea about the amount of waste generated and the amount of waste that has been recycled. So this is how. Then the author is saying that there should be monitoring, enforcement, there should be monitoring, enforcement, tracking. Global cooperation should be there, EPR target should be monitored, it should be achieved, avoiding leakage to the informal sector. So these things you can understand on your own. Then need of collection capabilities in decentralized manner. So author is saying that this collection capability should be decentralized. It means that in a given state, now we have only one center where collection can be done and recycling can be done. So this should not be the case. Rather, each district should have its own collection capability and recycling facilities. That means decentralized facilities should be there. So the benefit of decentralization will be there, that locally accessible, the facility will be locally accessible. So people will get incentivized to go there and give their discarded E items. So it will be easier to collect. देन अगेन बिकॉज ऑफ लोकलाइजेशन ऑफ रिसाइकलिंग फैसिलिटीज देयर विल बी रिडक्शन इन द ट्रांसपोर्टेशन कॉस्ट, एनर्जी कॉस्ट, सो लेस कार्बन फुटप्रिंट विल बी देयर. देन नाउ अगेन नेक्स्ट डायमेंशन इज अवेयरनेस अमंग द पीपल दैट देयर शुड बी रिस्पॉन्सिबल कंजम्पशन. कंजम्पशन शुड बी रिस्पॉन्सिबल. वाई हाउ वन मोबाइल इफ इट कैन रन फॉर 4 ईयर्स और 3 ईयर्स देन इट शुड बी यूज टू इट्स फुल फुल लाइफ. ओके दिस इज हाउ रिस्पॉन्सिबल कंजम्पशन, दिस इज हाउ द सस्टेनेबल कंजम्पशन. सो कंज्यूमर शुड लुक प्रोडक्ट यूज प्रोडक्ट फॉर इट्स यूजफुल लाइफ फुल लाइफ. कंज्यूमर शुड गो फॉर पॉसिबिलिटीज ऑफ रिपेयर ऑल्सो. दैट मीन्स दे शुड बिकम एनवायरमेंट कॉन्शसनेस शुड ऑल्सो बी देयर. दिस इज वॉट ऑथर इज एम्फेसाइजिंग. And how this can be done? This can be done by raising awareness. Who should be responsible for raising awareness? The media, the industry, because ultimately media has its role to raise awareness. Industry has also role of EPR. Okay, so this is how industry campaign should be there. For example, short animated videos, documentation of most exposed workers. These things can be used to raise the awareness. Okay. Then we have on the side of producers also, the product design should be safer, durable, repairable. That means the product could be repaired, could be recycled. That means plant obsolescence should not be there. The producer should have a point in view that the product should be used for its expected life, full life. Okay, few toxic materials should be used. And they should, the producer should emphasize on using more and more this recycled materials. So there should be emphasis on reuse the recyclable materials by the producers so that there is not mining of rare earth elements unnecessarily. Then we have a stakeholder analysis. This is also one point that the author is saying that there are two major stakeholders in the process. One is the business and the other is the public who are consumers. And media, of course, media has its role in raising awareness and various aspects. The role of government is that it should be a regulator. For example, various e-waste rules are there and it should be a facilitator in the self-propelled market. This is the market mechanism that the author is emphasizing. And for that, the government should be facilitated. How government should be facilitated? So government should create infrastructure. Okay. Policy regime should be there. This is how. Here two approaches are discussed. One is the Keynesian approach. That means the demand for e-waste recycling should be instigated by subsidies, by use of subsidies. But the government is, but the author is saying that we should not go for subsidies. In fact, Keynesian model we have studied in economics. Then neoclassical approach we have studied in economics. This approach is that there should be increased supply to formal recyclers. So recyclers should be empowered. How? There should be infrastructure, there should be increased supply. Okay. There should be closing of the infrastructure deficit. And thus when there is some facilitation of the an environment which is conducive for growth of the formal recycler, then there will be market, some market created for e-waste recycling. So this is how these things should be kept in mind. And we come to an end of this analysis. Hope you people would have enjoyed.
Live online classes are as effective as offline classes. Ethics with S. Ansari remains the best ever choice. Do you know that ethics paper is the only paper in general studies that pays more with less efforts? One can easily secure 130 to 140 marks. Luqman IAS is a well-established name since 2014 for ethics paper. We offer three types of courses: ethics foundation course, ethics case studies, and ethics test series. Since 2015, Luqman IAS students have maintained the records of securing the highest marks in this paper. Ethics Foundation course is starting from 21st of June 2021. Classes will be for 4 days in a week from 11 a.m. to 1:30 p.m. The course duration is of 60 days and the videos will be available for 75 days. There will be 43 classes of which 35 classes will be focused on theory and concept building, and 8 classes will be dedicated for case studies. There will be over 180 case studies and 3 tests. Since 4 months are left for prelims, one can easily finish the ethics paper before prelims itself, and it's a good opportunity. So, why to wait? Contact us today for more information.